Now, if you look up the word illustrious in the dictionary, it's defined as well-known, respected and admired for its past achievements. And if you think about the FJ range of vehicles, it is the very, very definition of the word illustrious. I mean, Mike calls this the ship of the desert, and he's absolutely right, because it's built to just keep going and going and going, even if it's really hot and dusty climates. The thing is, though, for me, it's more than that. It's a car for all seasons, because it's built to carry loads and loads of people, but still have all the modern things that you'd expect from an SUV. And on top of that, it's said that you can only kill a Land Cruiser with rust. Now, Mike has tasked me to fit a new gearbox in the car, and his famous last words were, "It's just a simple swap." Now, this is the original gearbox off the car, and I dropped it out in one big lump with the transfer case. And that same original transfer case is now broken down into all these tiny bits. And the reason I had to take it down so much is because you have to take it apart to remove it from the gearbox. And that's because this is a split transfer case. Now, this is our new replacement gearbox, and the gearbox in the Land Cruiser is critical. It's part of that bulletproof package. Problem is, our old one has a pretty average top end. In fact, Mike says it's around 60 miles an hour. But when you consider at the time, the speed limit in the US was around 55 miles an hour. It was all part of that Land Cruiser mentality, to build something that goes further, just not faster. But of course, today's demands have changed. People now want both. Now, Toyota realised this as well, so as the years went on, they also developed the gearboxes. Now, we're going to be using this, a later gearbox out of an FJ62. And straight away, you'll notice that it has this extra fifth gear, this overdrive gear, whereas you notice on the old one, it has the similar casing, but it's got this gap. Now, this new gearbox is going to allow for proper cruising speeds on really fast roads. And when you think about it, that's something that our Land Cruiser has never, ever experienced. Now, the FJ62 gearbox isn't available in the US, so Mike shipped this in and chosen it because it's a really popular upgrade. Now, I've given everything a clean and I've laid it all out on my bench. See, now's the time for the tricky bit. I've got to put it all back together, which means reassembling the transfer case to the gearbox and then fit both, the one big unit, back into the car. Right, the first part is this inner housing plate, which mounts here on the back of the gearbox. And the reason I'm showing you on the old gearbox is because it takes 8 bolts, of which this one, the middle one, is now obsolete because, of course, we have the fifth gear in the way. So to reuse this, I need to plug that hole, which I'm going to do with a simple tap and grommet. I'm using a half-inch tap to create threads within the aluminium housing, and a matching threaded grommet with a dab of liquid PTFE to plug the hole. Now, the last modification is this little plastic nipple here. Diverts oil into the fifth gear here. Now, if I spin that round, grab a new gasket, this. I'm just adding a little drop of sealer to these bolts, and then using a torque wrench, I'm gonna tighten them up. 47 foot-pounds. Right, now I can start with some internals, kicking off with this gear selector. Slides in there. Next up, I'm going to install this idler shaft. It should just slide in. Perfect, and then the idler gear itself, starting off with this little washer. I have to be really careful with the idler gears. Inside there, there's two sets of needle bearings that are likely to fall out. Perfect. Now, this chunk here, this is the rear outward gear. Line this hole up and then make sure all the gears mesh one at a time. Perfect. And give that a little whirl. Right, next is this, the main output gear. This slides on. This little collar. And then this bearing goes on here, but needs a little bit of persuasion. Now, I'm going to close all of this off, starting off first by fitting a new gasket, and then it all gets protected with this. Now, this is known as a split transfer case because you have to split it apart to get it off. Some models have it in one piece, but the split ones are seen as more reliable. It might be a bit of extra work, but I'd take reliability any day. Now, what's cool about this car is that every day it's a two-wheel drive car. It only engages the rear prop shaft and drives the rear wheels. It's only when you use the second gear stick, it engages the front prop shaft and the car becomes four-wheel drive. But above that, you need to get out the car and manually lock the front locking hubs. Now the car's four-wheel drive and it can tackle any terrain. I'm just going to use this torque wrench and tighten these down properly. Now, this cover plate here goes over this access hole at the back of the transfer case, and that hole's so you can fit a power takeoff tool or a PTO. What that basically means is that the owner can buy a bunch of accessories that fit onto the gearbox and take away the power. So if you have anything that requires a rotational movement, things like a drill or a water pump or a saw, you can basically fit it to the car, robbing the power from the engine. And to do that, you put the gearbox into drive, put the transfer case into neutral, and you basically divert the engine into your accessory. So all of a sudden, you've got a car that can go pretty much anywhere, and then when you get there, you've got the ability to pump water, drill a hole, winch something out, build a fence. I mean, it's pretty impressive. Right, next up is the drive shaft flange, which slides onto the splines. And then it's held on with a washer and a pretty hefty nut. So to hold this all in place, I've made a very simple bit of bar with two holes in, and then using the bigger torque wrench, perfect. Right, next up is this washer and another hefty nut. I'm going to use my trusty tool again. And then more sealant in the last cover. Right, next up is this really clever hollow bolt. And the reason it's hollow is it houses this tiny little spring, and on the end of that, this little ball bearing. Now, this one provides a tiny bit of pressure to this forward and back selector shaft. Goes in the side and then is locked in place. And next up, there's this little sensor that tells the car it's in four-wheel drive. Right, that's the bulk of my transfer case done. Now I get to reassemble the gear linkage, starting off with this dust boot. Then this bolt acts as a pivot. Goes into the side of the gearbox housing. And now the linkage slides into the pivot bolt. And then the shift lever. And then this end gets a split pin. Yeah, that's exactly how it should feel. Really positive. Right, so right now, the transfer case is in two-wheel drive high ratio. So if I turn the gearbox, simulating the engine running, it's going to put power into the rear wheels only. If, however, I move it back to four-wheel drive, still high ratio, turn the gearbox, it now not only drives the rear wheels, but it also drives the front wheels. If I move it into neutral, turn the engine. It's generating power through the gearbox, but the shafts aren't moving. The car's stationary, but you can add your PTO unit and drive another bit of kit. Move it down to low ratio. I'm still turning now four wheels, but the ratio's slightly lower. It's perfect for boggy ground. Now, this thing's quite heavy and bulky. You've just got to tackle it one bit at a time. I'm using this pole jack to take the pressure and weight so I can remove this big and clumsy trans jack. Now the trans jack's out of the way, I can attach the gearbox mount.
Click here to subscribe.